because you are infidels. And that's our answer. And Jefferson said, well, in that case, I will send a navy which will crush your state, which he did. And a good thing,
but there's
too. Islamic fundamentalism is not created by American democracy. It's a lie to say so. It's a masochistic lie. And it excuses those who are the real criminals, and it blames us for the attacks made upon us. Don't
equally,
have anything to do with this mentality.
The argument that we're there fighting them so they won't come and fight us
is a bullshit argument.
Ridiculous argument.
Fight them everywhere.
You ask anyone in London this
everywhere.
Summer whether...
Now, that statement, this will not stand, doesn't translate into how we're going to make it not stand.
It was the most intense combat they'd seen since Vietnam.
The supply convoys did in Iraq are as vulnerable as those in Vietnam. And the gun trucks protecting the convoys, similarly underarmed. McCormick knows it is adapt or die, and he looks to history for an answer.
The rise of the Islamic State has its roots in that battle and its aftermath.
The battle for Fallujah.
At the time, it was the most dangerous city in the world.
Reif, a year into his service, was a machine gunner in the 2004 battle.
We needed to take that city in order to basically take Iraq. And then there's kind of a point in the battle where you almost kind of accept the fact that you're not going to survive. Then you're just doing your job.
More than four dozen Americans were killed to capture the city.
Country that's just undergone a terrorist attack and is expecting the possibility of a worse one, and you're confronted with a dictator who has praised this attack and given shelter to some of the people past and present who are interested in that kind of thing, which we know that Saddam was doing, and can be proved to anyone, and are you going to face your voters and say, well, let's give him the benefit of the doubt. Let's grant Saddam Hussein the presumption of innocence. This is also, as you say, the only regional government that has actually used weapons of mass destruction, not just within its own borders, but against Iran as well. It has a proven record of concealment, a special ministry to conceal weapons and to deceive inspectors, who, by the way, are not investigators. They're supposed to be just monitors. I think that the only thing you could possibly say is there's no more presumption of innocence here. There's no more benefit of the doubt. We're going to say as if. And nothing else would be sane or defensible.
The tyrant will soon be gone.
I'll bring in Senator Bernie Sanders of Vermont. He was a member of the House of Representatives in 2002 when he voted against the last war in Iraq. Senator Sanders, thanks very much for joining us tonight. What's your reaction to the president's remarks overall tonight?
Well, Rachel, let me start off on a tangent that I think many others are not taking. There is no question that ISIS is a dangerous and brutal organization and that they have got to be stopped. We focus our attention on defeating ISIS. So the goal, it seems to me, is to address the crisis in the Middle East.
Senator Sanders, I agree with your foreign policy so often, and I think it's Chris Matthews, and I think the big lesson of Vietnam, which you and I grew up together learning, was you go into a country, you try to change its course of its history, and then you come home, and you're leaving the people behind to run that country. We're not going into Syria, and somehow we have this notion we can change the course of its history. And I just wonder what you think about that. Well, is it arrogance? We're going to change the course of Syrian history by
you're
a bombing
not going to change,
campaign.
Chris, of course you're right. You're not going to change the course of Syrian history. I think what Chris is saying, there are a heck of a lot of unintended consequences once you get into war. Maybe we send troops into combat.
And then you have a perpetual war, decade after decade, in an incredible morass of the Mideast. Now, I think the president has been criticized. He wasn't tough like Cheney and Bush. Thank God we have got the help. The so-called Syrian moderates, God knows how many of them that there are. I think airstrikes are important.
Senator Bernie Sanders of Vermont, thank you so much for being with us tonight.
I want to start by repeating what I've said since the beginning. This will not be quick. Our coalition's now hit ISIL with more than 5,000 airstrikes.
This is an ABC News special report.
Let's go straight to President Biden at the White House and announce the killing of the leader of ISIS.
United States counterterrorism operation killed al-Baghdadi. Since then, ISIS has directed terrorist operations targeting Americans, our allies and our partners, and countless civilians in the Middle East, Africa, and in South Asia. Haji Abdullah oversaw the spread of ISIS-affiliated terrorist groups around the world after savaging communities and murdering innocents. He was responsible for the recent brutal attack on a prison in northeast Syria holding ISIS fighters, which was swiftly addressed by our brave partners in the Syrian Democratic Forces. He chose to blow himself up, not just to the vest, but to blow up that third floor, rather than face justice for the crimes he has committed, taking several members of his family with him, just as his predecessor did. I'm grateful for the immense courage and skill and determination of our U.S. forces. I'm late, and thank you for your time. Appreciate it.
Mr. President,
the threat from ISIS has been eliminated, sir.
How many U.S. troops are involved, sir?
Our civilization was born on the land where Iraq is today. Here, more than 5,000 years ago, humanity organized itself into a society of tens of thousands of people, invented writing, and gave agriculture and architecture unprecedented development. This exceptional, still unknown heritage reminds us of the madness of ISIS, who since 2014 has proceeded with the destruction and systematic theft of mankind's heritage. The main sites of northern Mesopotamia were erased from the archaeological map. Centuries of history reduced to dust.
Towards the end of the First World War, the British were in possession of three Ottoman provinces that make up modern Iraq. Unlike modern Iraq, the social and economic environment was much different in 1918. The vast majority of the country had never been exposed to a central government.
London. King Faisal of Iraq, on his first visit to England, is greeted by King George. The two kings were driven to Buckingham Palace in state.
Our cameraman in Iraq now sends us these pictures of the famous Arab Legion working in conjunction with our forces during the final attack leading to the capture of the fortress.
Her capital is Baghdad, a name that conjures up all the romance of Harun al-Rashid and the Arabian Nights of 1,000 years ago. 2,000 years before Christ. The world's first code of justice was laid down in the halls of Babylon. Today, in Baghdad, a modern police force upholds the laws of a sovereign state.
Well, Saddam Hussein came to power because he was a member of the Ba'ath Party, which was like a revolutionary Arab nationalist party. And thanks to the internal politics of the Ba'ath Party, his relatives from his own tribal area became very powerful in the military bureau of the Ba'ath, and they were effectively the ones who carried out the coup d'etat in 1968, which brought the Ba'ath to power. So his cousin, Ahmed Hassan al-Bakr, became president of Iraq, and on his coattails, as it were, the young Saddam was drawn upwards. And the young Saddam had made himself very useful to Hassan al-Bakr, because Hassan al-Bakr was a military officer, he could rally the troops, he could rally the officer corps, but he didn't know much about the rest of Iraq, whereas Saddam Hussein had been very effective in organizing street gangs, underground networks, intelligence organizations. And so as the regime started to establish itself throughout Iraq, he became an invaluable figure. And one of the things you watch happening in the early 70s is effectively Saddam Hussein pushes himself forward and becomes, as he put it, the strong man of Iraq, although he wasn't effectively the president of Iraq. He doesn't become president of Iraq until 1979, when he persuades his cousin that ill health has now prevented him from pursuing his career as president of Iraq and pushes him aside. But of course, it was because he himself felt he had enough strength to effectively displace his cousin and become president directly. And so Saddam Hussein works his way up through, if you like, the politics of conspiracy, but also through the military politics, which were very characteristics of Iraq, and finds himself as president of Iraq in 1979.
The year was 1979. Saddam Hussein, the charismatic president of Iraq, was ruling with a rod of iron. Saddam was endlessly ambitious, modeling himself on Stalin. He dreamt of ruling through his Ba'ath Party the entire Arab world.
What's happening is that the war on land between Iran and Iraq is spilling over into the sea, with Western tankers being the sitting targets for both sides. From the Gulf, this report by Julian Mannion.
The Arab oil fields. It is 10 years since the oil embargo brought Western Europe to its knees. Today, anxious eyes are once again turned towards the Persian Gulf, which still provides 20% of the free world's supplies. Missiles against tankers are the weapons that both sides are using to try and break the stalemate in their war on land. Iraq began with exocets. Iran has hit back at ships like this one, the Chemical Venture. A bright red fountain, the Fountain of Blood, is a symbol of the revolutionary regime.
Today was day one of the long-awaited ceasefire in the Persian Gulf War.
Take your seats. Good afternoon, Marines.
Good afternoon.
Just north of us, Saddam Hussein's got 1 million Iraqi soldiers. They will stop at nothing. They've used nerve gas against the Iranians and the Kurds. Now here's a picture.
It was just before Desert Storm. We were on a routine recon inside Iraqi-controlled terrain, assessing enemy troop strength for what Saddam Hussein promised would be the mother of all wars.
Iraq's army is defeated.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim.
AA, find out how many planes are in the air.
Yes.
It's good these televisions working.
Can I get the president on the line, please?
That's right. We got planes in the air. Nowhere for them to land.
I still have one plane on the count of four flying over Pennsylvania.
And permission for them to land at a Canadian airport.
Flying over Pennsylvania, of course. And three other planes are unaccounted for.
Yes, that is correct.
Mr. Vice President, POTUS on line one, sir.
Mr. President? The situation is extremely fluid. I strongly recommend you stay in the air. I have sequestered congressional leadership. Okay, then.
Sir, Don Rumsfeld is at the Pentagon on line three.
That?
Mm-hmm. Yes, sir.
Dick, are there still passenger planes in the air? I need rules of engagement.
Yeah, well, let's get the president back online, sir.
You have authorization to shoot down any aircraft deemed a threat.
Presidential authority?
That is correct.
Many Iraqis can hear me tonight in a translated broadcast, and I have a message for them. The tyrant will soon be gone. The day of your liberation is near. All the decades of deceit and cruelty have now reached an end. Saddam Hussein and his sons must leave Iraq within 48 hours. Their refusal to do so will result in military conflict, commenced at a time of our choosing. Events in Iraq have now reached the final days of decision.
Ladies and gentlemen, we got him.